We worked out the partition function. In the last class, we worked out the partition function for free scalar fields in the torus, and we found that z of tau is equal to, I think we got 1 by 4 pi, 2 pi to the power 26, alpha prime, and in tau to the power 13. And then we got everything else that we got from the oscillators, which was non-zero point energies, which I'll fix up in a moment, but first is this clear. Now we have to include the contribution of 0 point energies. Okay, so the contribution of 0 point energy is two sources. The first, that energies on the cylinder differ from scaling dimensions on the plane by a factor of minus c divided by 26. Again, okay, that L0 differs by L0, the plane by minus c divided by 26, and L0 bar differs by and the other scaling, the anti-angulating scaling on the plane by c divided by 26. C left and c right are equal to the scales. Just one c. Okay, so that gives you a factor of q bar. Now, what was the eccentric charge of this theory? C divided by 24. Conformity theory formula says that L0 is equal to C by 24. And what is the center charge? Okay, what was the center charge of the whole theory, matter plus host? What is the center charge of matter? 20? We have 6 different matter fields. So this theory, I have center charge minus 26. That's how it all worked out, right? So this thing is minus 26. Okay, we get a plus that now the ground shift energy shifts by minus c. So this is plus 13 by 12. Okay, this is like now these two signs can't both be the same, so there's a problem. They have to be opposite. It was the same shift. Which did we mark up on? This would have negative energy, so this should have been minus. The energy of the ground state of the free boson state.
But,
it's like,
what is
free boson? I'm sorry, both.
Bosons get the opposite contribution this way.
You're totally right. You're completely right. That was right. Thank you. Yes. Absolutely. Thank you. Yes, one is the way back. Thank you. Okay, yes. Okay, great. So, that would be from the central charge. So, there's one more factor here that we haven't done properly. Can somebody tell me what that is? What?
It is that we have considered them as physical goes with the plus sign.
If we're computing this thing, just 20 to the power minus beta h, this is accurate. So that's not the problem. But there's one more something with 0 point energies. What's that? What was the scaling dimension of the lowest energy operator of the BC system? Minus 1. We started counting as if the vacuum had scaling dimension 0. It actually had minus 1. Okay? So we need to add an additional factor of qq bar to the power minus 1. Is this clear? Okay, so the final answer for trace, so let me just write it again. So trace of e to the power minus beta h is equal to Q bar, and I'll just keep these factors explicit since eventually they cancel later. In the QQ bar into minus 1 into all of this stuff. Into this product. Okay. That's good. But this trace is not what we want to calculate. This trace is not what we want to calculate when we calculate the functional string theory. Now the reason for that is that the calculation that we want to do is the
calculation of the path integral of the BC system on the torus. Now, the question we should ask is, with what boundary conditions do we do this path integral on the torus? And the answer is given from the logic of the Fudgy group of gauge fixing method. B and C have to do with diffeomorphism fields and things to do with metric and the axis and so on, all of which were periodic. So clearly, when we go through, when we review where all this came from, we want the BC system, we want to do this path integral with BC, with the boundary conditions of the BC system periodic. Okay? However, there is this fact about path integrals of anti-commutative fields, which is that if you want a path integral representation of trace e to the power minus beta h, then what you should be doing is, I should say more clearly, this is trace of q to the power l0 q to the power pi l. This is really not the system. Okay? If you want a path integral representation for that, then that path integral representation is given by choosing the anti-commuting variables to be anti-periodic as you go around the time cycle. So the path integral that we're interested in for the purpose of string theory is not the path integral that computes this object. So, firstly, from boundary. Secondly, we've not put in our insertions. Remember what we wanted was this thing with a C, a C bar, B, and a B bar insertion. Okay? So, let's try to fix up the boundary. So let's try and find a Hilbert space, an operator expression for an object, for the object that is given by periodic boundary conditions. And it's clear what that is. That's simply trace of minus 1 to the power x times q to the l0 q bar phi 0 bar, where f is defined as an operator, where minus 1 to the f is defined as an operator that anti-commutes with both the B and the C fields, and thereby commutes with binding as these fields. Okay? This object, because this object gives an additional minus sign as you close up the path integral when you go from t equals 0 to t equals beta, it changes the boundary conditions from plus to minus for the fields that are charged under the sign. Both B and C are charged under the sign, so it fixes up the boundary conditions. Okay, so it's fine. So if we were interested in just the path integral with no insertions, that would be computing this object. That would be computing in Hamiltonian language this object. Now, can somebody tell me what the value of this object is? Good. Okay. What you said is completely right. In fact, it's just this thing is equal to qq bar to the power minus 1, qq bar to the power 13 by 12, and then let's write this in with a little more care. This n product of n is equal to 0 to infinity, 1 minus q to the power n. It's a minus sign, now, because each oscillator changes the sign at this point. Yeah? 1 minus q bar to the power n, and the whole thing. Square. Now, can somebody tell me what that evaluates to? Pay careful attention to the limits in this product. Look at the lower limit of this product and then do it. Zero. It evaluates to zero. The lower limit gives 0 factor of 0 times 0. Okay? Okay, now why is that? We already knew that we got zero density. I mean, we got zero anyway. We knew that because we know that we do the path integral with periodic boundary conditions around the stars. We have C0 modes and B0 modes. The integral over the C0 modes will give you zero, the integral over the B0 modes will give you zero. So zero is totally correct. It's physical. Okay? The path integral of the torus without insertions is just zero. Okay? Just to say it again, here, hidden in this notation here, we also included the contribution of the zero modes. The zero modes don't carry any energy, so it just gives you a multiplicity. You see, in the BC system, we have the upstate and the downstate, both for left movers and for right movers. So a total of four states at every energy level. If we were just computing trace e to the power minus beta h, we would get a just a degeneracy factor of 4 times whatever you get from the actual status. Okay? However, if you computing trace e to the power minus 1 to the f times this, all of these states, if under some convention, two of them are positive fermion number, the other two have negative fermion number, because they relate to each other by the action of a zero mode which carries negative fermion number. Okay, so for instance, if we say that down carries positive fermion number, then up will also carry positive fermion number, but up, down, and up, down will carry negative fermion number. So at every energy level, we've got as many states with positive fermion numbers, negative energy number, therefore raising to the power minus 1. Of minus 1 to the f, but minus 1 to the h just vanishes. Okay, so good. So this quantity we know how to calculate, but that's not much use since it's zero. It's also not the quantity we want. The quantity we want involves insertions of these guys. Insertion of one factor of a c and a b, a factor of a c bar and a b bar. Okay? Now, as we've seen before, it's only the insertions, in although these insertions have specific positions, it's only the zero modes that matter. And when you take that, write that field out and expand it, it's only the contribution to the zero mode that matters. Anything that doesn't have a zero mode will vanish anyway. Okay? So what? So this thing is proportional to C0, B0, C bar 0. B0, C0, B bar 0. Okay? Now, let's forget about the right movers for a moment. Let's just look at the left movers. Okay. This quantity evaluated on a... You see, remember that all the states in the BC system come in two flavors. There's the down, which is annihilated by V0, and then there's the up, which is annihilated by C0. Okay? All up states don't contribute to this quadratic function. Like I mentioned, because it's annihilated by C0. Only the down states contribute. Similarly, on the right moving sector, it's only the down state right movers that contribute. So, with these insertions, what we get? With these insertions, the only role of the insertions is to take that, is to calculate the same object that we had here, except to keep the contribution from only one of those four states. Okay? Now, that one of those four states that my convention said is down now. So it's a particular fermion number charge. So let's say plus. Okay? So, with the only difference that comes about from adding these insertions is that this formula gets modified to n equals 1 to infinity. Okay? So the final answer is that ZBC, you know, the appropriate Z we want to calculate, the string theory, this product n is equal to 1 to infinity, 1 minus q to the power n, 1 minus q bar to the power n, whole thing squared, times qq bar to the power 13 by 12, times qq bar to the power.
Okay. What, I mean, the zero mode don't contribute any part.
Yeah. Is it zero volts or just oscillators like anything else? Except that they carry no energy. So all that the zero modes did was to generate the four state system. And the projector projects to one of those four states. No, no, you see, there's a fermionic zero modes. You see, quantization of fermionic zero modes is two state system. So we're going to contribute a numerical factor 4 to this function. Because there are 4. It's a multiplicity of 4. But since you project on one of those 4, it's no negative. It's just 1. It's just a degeneracy. Is this clear? Fine. Okay, so now let's put it all together. So first, let's compute Z matter times Z DC. Okay, so what do we get? We get, you see, that of these infinite products, we have 26 in the denominator and 2 in the numerator. So what we're left with is 4. 24. We have all of these factors of q cube up to the power 13 by 12, the numerator and the denominator, as Logan and I pointed out, cancel. So those go away. We still have this explicit factor of q cube up to the power minus 1. Yes, we still have the fact that this explicit factor of q cube up to the power minus 1. And so we can rewrite this thing. And then we have whatever we got from the zero points, the matter zero. So we can rewrite this thing as 1 over 2 pi to the power 26, alpha prime to the power 13, m tau to the power 13, okay, times 1 by q q bar times the product, n is equal to 1 to infinity, 1 minus q to the power n, 1 minus q bar to the power n, the whole thing. Okay, now, just because you're going to see it in many other contexts, I'm going to introduce some notation. Okay, this notation is that the eta function. Okay, so definition. Okay, q to the power 1 by 24. Okay, q to the power 1 by 24, product n is equal to 1 to infinity, 1 over 1 minus q to the power n. Is defined as eta of q. Okay? With this definition, our partition function becomes, with this definition, our partition function becomes 1 over 2 pi to the power 26, alpha prime to the power 13, m tau, okay, it's convenient to write this as, okay, as 1 over m tau times 1 over 2 pi to the power 26, alpha prime to the power 13, m tau to the power 12, and eta of R.
Did we have a photo?
Yes, that's good. Okay. Now, let me give you a small, let's undertake a small diversion. A small diversion about, you know, this eta function was defined long before string theory, by mathematicians. And it has Ginsparg said in one of his lecture notes, one of the lecture notes in which I learned to also start as a student. You might think that it was a big coincidence that Jacobian friends define exactly the function that you will need for string theory, including the q to the power minus 1 by 24. Now why did they do that? They did that because, of course it's not coincidence. They did that because they were interested in functions with good modular properties. Okay, so that's the thing that I'm going to tell you about for the next 10 minutes. But modular properties of functions. You see, when you write down a function of tau, you've got a function of a variable. But suppose you're interested not in functions of variables, but in functions of Riemann surfaces. That is, you are interested in a function that evaluates to the same thing on two tori that are actually the same Riemann surface. We've already seen in the last lecture that different values of tau can correspond to the same Riemann surface. Yeah. So, different values of tau correspond to the same Riemann surface if they're related by SL2Z transformations. Okay? So, mathematicians were interested in defining functions on Riemann surfaces. Functions of the space of tori are interested in functions that have good modular transformation properties. That is, transform in a particular, in some nice way under modular transformations. That is, under the variable change, tau goes to some SL2Z map. Is this clear? In particular, at the moment, as we will see in string theory, we would be interested in modular invariant objects. Because once again, in string theory, we are going to integrate over the partition function over tau, right? And of course, we should get the same answer for the partition function if the same torus is parametrized in some different way. So the full partition function that appears in our, you know, the full integral that we do has to be modular invariant. Otherwise, this cut down that we talked about last time, from integrating over the space of all tau's to integrating only over the fundamental domain, makes no sense. Even depending on if it was not modular invariant, it would depend on which fundamental domain you choose. Okay? So both mathematicians and string theorists are interested in functions with a good modular transformation. Okay? Now, what can we say about the modular transformation properties of eta? Jacobi and friends and, you know, all those characters used interesting and abstruse mathematics, well, from my point of view, abstruse mathematics, to prove the following formula. To prove that m tau to the half times eta of q times eta q bar is modular invariant. Okay? And, you know, this only works when you define eta with this factor of q to the power 1 by 24. That's why I did that. That was the reason for their definition. Now, I don't want to give you a physicist's proof of this statement. We've already seen the proof, but I just want to emphasize it. And the physicist's proof of the statement is simply the following. Remember that we have argued that the path integral of the free boson conformal field theory. Part of the integral of the free boson conformal field theory, let's take a single free boson. A single free boson, part of the integral of the free boson conformal field theory, on a torus modular parameter tau, is simply the inverse of this object. Do you remember? We had the 0 point energy shift, that was q to the power minus 1 by 24. So that's a q to the power 1 by 24 in the denominator. And then we got this from the zero point, from the zero point, 1 over square root, imaginary part of tau. Okay? But that path integral is well defined on the torus. So that is clearly a function of the torus. You know, you reparametrize the torus some different way, you'll get the same answer for the path integral. Is this clear? You know, so provided that we're dealing with a good diffeomorphically invariant theory. So that the path integral of this theory on a certain space makes sense. This answer must be modular invariant. We'll come back to this issue when dealing with fermions. This won't turn out to be automatically true with fermions. We'll try to understand why. It's because the diffeomorphism anomaly with fermions. But we come back to that when we study fermions. But for the boson, there's no subtlety. You understand what I mean? You've got some space. The path integral of this theory is well defined on the space, and it's a function of what space you're doing the path integral. It's not a function of how you parameterize the space, provided that the theory is actually diffeomorphically invariant, which the free boson theory certainly is. Is this clear? Okay? So, since we get this result from a path integral that is well defined as a function of the Riemann surface, not a parameterization of the Riemann surface, it must be the same no matter how you parameterize the Riemann surface. So this thing, for all different values of tau that give you the same Riemann surface, okay, must give the same answer. Okay, there's one thing I've hidden here in this glib demonstration. It is that modular transformations don't actually give you the same metric. It only gives you the same metric up to a conformal factor. Okay? So I've used not just that the free boson conformal field theory is diffeomorphically invariant, but also that it's invariant under conformal transformations. Okay? So, but both these are true statements. We understand
but this is a free boson without any close.
Yes. It's a conformal field theory with central charge 1. That's fine.
But the non-zero central charge doesn't make
any... It makes no difference on the state. You see, you're just taking two different tori that are related by, whose volumes are related, whose metrics are related by constant factor. So all that you require is scale invariance, actually, which is certainly true. You know, if you had to do some coordinate dependent change, it might be a difference. But for this statement, it makes a difference. Okay. So if you think through this fact, although you might find it hard to prove directly using mathematics, you might have to go and look up Jacobian friends. If you wanted to prove directly using mathematics that this thing was modular invariant, which I assure you it is, you know, there's a huge branch of mathematics that deals with such things. And this is the big example of these things. I recently encountered modular forms of genus 2 Riemann surfaces, and some people eat them for breakfast. They're quite horrible things, in my opinion. but this is a big example as far as mathematics is concerned. Of course. Okay, but still, it's true and anyway, you might find it hard to prove. It's not that hard. This one can prove without too much. I don't know. Okay, but from the point of view of physics, you know that it actually is true. From the argument we just gave. Okay, so now let's look at this. So our final answer we've written in this form. In particular, I've kept in tau to power 12 here, so as to make this thing explicitly modular. Okay? So, what was our final path integral of string theory? Our final path integral of string theory was d tau bar times 4 pi m tau. Let's combine that m tau with this m tau, so we get 4 pi m tau the whole thing squared times all the sum stuff. Okay. Now, while it's not obvious, it's true, and it's a simple algebraic exercise, I'm going to leave it for you to check, that this integration measure is also modular invariant. Okay? So what you have to do to check that, you just do the change of variables. And if you do the change of variables, tau prime is equal to a tau plus b over c tau plus d. You do it in tau, you do it in tau y, you do it in tau, and you check that it's true. Okay, it's a 2-3 minute exercise that we work on. So it's all working very beautifully. The original measure that we got from public Popov page fixing, which had one factor in tau in the denominator, was not modular invariant. Okay? But you got an extra factor of in tau in the denominator from the fact that while the VC system cancelled the oscillator part of the XCFT. It didn't cancel the zero mode part of the XCFT. Okay? So, the XCFT, there were 26 directions. Two of the oscillators of those 26 were cancelled by the VC system. But, each pair of dimensions added a factor of 1 over e term the denominator. Okay? So, there was one overall hanging in term of the denominator that wasn't cancelled by anything. So the in-towers that went with 24 oscillators that survived, combined with the contribution of those oscillators, to give you something more independent. But there was one over in-tower that was hanging around. That combines with the in-tower of the measure to now give you an explicitly more independent measure. So that's very good. Okay, so we have finally now fixed on our formula that we are interested in, that we're going to study, for the partition function of the bosonic string on the torus. Any questions or comments? Okay. So now, we can use this formula to try to explore a very important property of loop amplitudes in string theory. We can try to use this formula to try to explore a very important property of loop amplitudes in string theory, namely the UV finiteness of the amplitudes. Okay? So in order to do that, what we're going to try to reinterpret this formula. Okay, we're going to try to reinterpret this formula in terms of a vacuum. Okay, remember that we discussed the thing that we're computing by computing this formula. As of now, we've not got the finite temperature yet. So, as of now, the thing that we're computing by computing this formula is the vacuum energy of string theory. Now, we're doing this at one loop, but at one loop in field theory is simply given by free field theory. It's this diagram. You know, summed over every particle that can run in there. So, what we're doing is this vacuum energy calculation in string theory, which we should. Now you might think the following. You might think, well, okay, I should be able to do the following. I should be able to. But this calculation should be closely tied to the following calculation. I know the answer for how to do one loop calculations for vacuum energy for free fields, for free field theory. And I also know that, you know, since at this level, you don't see any interactions. I also know that, at least in some way, free string theory is simply a sum of free field theories, one field theory for each of the particles of string theory. So let me take this answer that I got and compare it with the vacuum energy that I would have got from each of the particles of string theory running in this loop. Okay, so that's the exercise that we're going to go through. We're going to try to do the computation for a particle of mass m, a scalar particle of mass m running in this loop. We're going to try to compute the vacuum energy. And then take that answer and sum it over, take that answer and sum it over the spectrum of particles in string theory and compare them. No, we don't. In fact, these two will differ. Let's hold that question till we get to the
That
is not fine. Right.
Because all of the bosons.
What?
All of the
states are bosons. They don't cancel in any way. Yes. You'll see. Hang on for 10-15 minutes. Okay, so now let's try and just do this calculation. So what are we going to try to do? So firstly, let's try to do the calculation of the vacuum energy. Let's try to do the calculation of the vacuum energy for a free boson of mass. Okay. Now I'm going to present a formula written in a way that will be convenient for us. Okay? And for this calculation, and motivate them in two separate ways. Well, actually, maybe I should just give you. Okay. So, firstly, if you were just doing this in field theory, what would you do? What would you do? You see, what is the calculation you need to do? So, suppose you looked at d phi exponential of minus del phi the whole thing squared by 2 minus m squared phi squared by 2. Let's put a minus outside. Okay? So, now what we want to do is to do the path integral. Of course, we're only looking at connected diagrams. So we want to take the logarithm of the diagrams. Okay? So if we do the path integral, what we get? Let's split it up mode by mode into momentum. For each mode, we get a factor of 1 over k squared plus m squared. Okay? What we actually want to do is calculate the log. So we get a product of such modes, so we get the sum of logs. Okay? So there's some keeping track of with what factors of 2 pi and so on. But sort of clearly what we're going to get is dk by 2 pi to the power of k times integral of the logs of k squared plus m. The answer is to be proportional. Right? Now, I'm going to give you another form of writing this answer that will be more convenient for our interpretation. And this other form of writing this answer is the form that you would get if you thought of field theory in first quantized language. This is the sum over all particle parts. Okay. So first, let me give you the answer, and then these two things will be mathematically equivalent. And then we will also see the interpretation. So the form is 1 over 2L dL exponential of minus half k squared plus m squared times dk over 2 pi. This is basically the treatment. Exactly. So how do we know this is correct? Well, suppose we didn't have the L in here. So suppose we take this expression. Suppose we take, before we do the integral over L, suppose we just look at this. Look at this expression, and we differentiate it with respect to n. Okay, we take this expression here, and suppose we look at this. Okay. What I'm saying is the obvious fact that e to the power minus L x is equal to 1 over x. This is L is integrated from 0. This integral is from 0 to infinity. Okay? So e to the power minus L x integrated from 0 to infinity. Okay? Is this one. So now, if I want to get a set of 1 over x, if I'm interested in the log, I integrate both sides. The integral gives me a 1 over L inside the integral on the left hand side, gives me a log on the right hand side. And that's what I'm going to do. This 1 over 2 goes with this one. Is this clear? So this is an integral representation for this log n. Okay? So from that point of view, this is just a mathematical rewriting of this formula. But I want to stress that this is a mathematical rewriting that has a physical interpretation. I won't be important for calculation, but just so that you see, what's going on here is what you are doing is suppose we were doing field theory in first quantized formats. This takes us back actually to the first couple of classes that we discussed that we had in this course, when we were discussing how to quantize a relativistic particle in first quantized language. You remember that the action that we were using, at this there was this integral d tau, there was a factor of m plus x dot squared by 2, oh yeah, I'm going to get quite messed up. I think there was an m here, and so on. There was an action somewhat like this on the wavelength of the free particle. You remember we started with the square root g, with just the square root g action, and then we went to Polyakov form. And the Polyakov form of the action had an additional constant here, and then this thing with this is a way. Okay, this is where we gauge fix so that the metric on the world line is 1. So we got something somewhat like this. I can't remember the factors of 2 in the minus signs. Okay, now, so if you were doing a one loop calculation in this format, what you're supposed to be doing is to choose every possible length. See, the only modulus now, we're supposed to take parts of particles that close up into a circle. The modulus in this game now is the length of the circle. Okay, so you're supposed to do the partition function calculation of this quantum mechanical system on a circle of length L, and then sum over all lengths. This part here is the partition function of this quantum mechanical system on a circle of length L. Right, because e to the power minus beta times Hamilton of quantum mechanics. This is, as far as quantum mechanics is concerned, this is just a non-relativistic quantum mechanical system. Right, beta, length L, is like the temperature of the system. That's why I'm multiplying by L. Is this clear? Okay. And then you're supposed to sum over particles of all of the moduli. So all of the lengths of the parts. Okay? You're supposed to do that with some measure. You would have to think a little bit about what the measure is. But, you know, the answer to field theory is that the measure is dl by l. Dl by 2l. You would have to go through the kind of exercise we went through for string theory in order to determine the correct measure and moduli space of these parts. But we know the answer by, because we know the answer. It's the end. Okay? So the answer for the vacuum energy from field theory has this lovely interpretation in terms of parts. Okay? It's compute the partition function for this quantum mechanical system. Compute the partition function for the quantum mechanical system on a circle of fixed size. That is a very easy calculation because that's a Hamiltonian interpretation of that formula. It's simply trace e to the power minus size of circle times spectrum of Hamiltonian, integrated over the spectrum. That's what we've done. We've got the spectrum, okay? Integrated, multiplied by length of circle. Okay? So that's the partition function from this one mechanical point of view, and then you integrate over all moduli. And that gives you the field theory answer for the vacuum energy of the system. It's quite beautiful, isn't it? I mean, just independently of anything else, it's quite a beautiful fact. This is like final way of thinking of field theory. Well, this is the second part of this. same answer. Okay? So that's right. So this is what the vacuum energy of a free particle of mass m looks like. Now, suppose we had a whole bunch of free particles of mass m. Okay? Suppose we had a whole bunch of free particles of mass m. What would we do? Well, what we would do is to sum these connected components of vacuum energy. So sum these vacuum energies over all masses. Okay? So you see, we can interchange the summation and the integration and perform the summation first here. And then do the integration. So let's see what we get when we perform that summation first. Okay? So what we have to do is to perform the sum over all the particles exponential of minus half m squared n. Okay. Now, to make the answer look better, I'm going to do something better. We'll put that on, but that's all outside the summation. So, a uniform factor outside the summation. So that's the thing that basically just okay. Now, you see that this L has some analogy with the moduli of string theory, but it has two differences. Firstly, L is a real number, whereas the modulus of string theory is a complex. Secondly, L has dimensions. M squared, L has dimensions of 1 over n squared, okay, whereas the modulus of string theory, periodic to pi, has no dimensions. Okay, so this, the first difference, we'll see how that's mentioned. Well, let's get to the second difference immediately by performing a change of variables on this one. Okay? Now we should get our change of variables correct. And the one that will be useful. So that is let's write tau 2 equals L by. Okay? So when we do this, what do we get? We get sum over particles exponential of minus m squared alpha prime by 2 into tau. So we have to do the same integral just with these new variables. And let's rewrite everything here in terms of tau 2. So we have tau 2 alpha prime, yeah, and here we will get tau 2 alpha prime. Well, this cancels. This was just to d tau 2 d. This cancels the measure. Okay. Now let's remember what we can say about the mass square of states in string theory. You remember that the mass square of states in string theory was given by the following formula. The mass square was equal to 4 by alpha prime into L naught minus 1. No, so this one, which is also equal to 4 by alpha prime into L naught bound. We had an independent condition from left move as a right move. Okay, so as you suggested, we have to do two things. We have to make sure that the left moving and right moving L naughts are the same, because otherwise these two formulas have to match. Okay, but we can write this formula in a more symmetric fashion. Symmetric between L naught and L naught bar by saying that actually we have m squared is equal to 2 by alpha prime into L naught plus L naught bar. Therefore, squared alpha prime by 2 is equal to L naught plus A naught bar. Okay, so this trace that we wanted to perform here is simply sum over all particles of exponential of minus L naught plus L naught bar minus 2 into time. Now, we know that we have for every path A infinity, you know. Now you might be tempted to say the following. Might be tempted to say, well, this sum over all particles, since there's one-to-one correspondence between the oscillator states, since there's one-to-one correspondence between the oscillator states of the 24 free boson system, okay, and the particles of string theory, okay, that you might be tempted to say, well, all we have to do is to replace the sum of our particles by a trace over the Hilbert space of the 24 free bosons of the conformality theory of 24 free bosons. That's almost right, not quite. What have we forgotten? We just mentioned it too. Do you have a particle for every state of the system of the oscillators of the 24 free bosons? No, right? It's only those states that obey level matching, where L0 is equal to L0 bar. You can choose any L0, but you must choose the same L0 bar. Once you do that, you get a particular string theory. Because that was one of the constraints. You see, we solved all the constraints except this one, just by writing, like this. You just formulate it like this. So we have to include that constraint before just doing blindly the trace over the free boson theory. We have to include the constraint that L0 is equal to L0. Now remember that L0 and L0 bar are integers. So, in particular, the difference between L0 and L0 bar is integers. So, we want a delta function, something that we want to insert a delta function of L0 minus L0 bar into this formula. And you might think that the way to do it is to integrate e to the power I theta L0 minus L0 bar, integral of theta from minus infinity to infinity. But we already know that the only possible values of L0 and L0 bar are integers. And what we want is not a delta function that becomes infinity when L0 is equal to L0 bar, which is what that integral representation would have given you, but a delta function that becomes 1 when L0 is equal to L0 bar, when only allowed values are integers, because there's a very convenient representation for such a delta function, which is 1 over 2 pi integral from 0 to 2 pi of e to the power I theta L0 minus L0 bar. I'll call this tau 1. Let's call this minus minus 1. See, when L0 minus L0 bar are integers, you don't need to do the integral of all of the real line, because that integral of all of the real line just gives you copies of what you're getting from minus pi to pi. And it's that's redundant to do the integral over all of space. And in fact, that redundancy allows you to normalize things to 1. It's clear when n0 is equal to n0 bar, 1 over 2 pi is the right position. Okay, so this quantity is equal to delta L0 L0. Okay, so now let's put this into here. Okay, let's put this guy into here and then do the trace over the free bosons, the 24 free bosons. So work. And so we concluded that the part of that formula that was summing over the masses of particles is given by trace of 1 by 2 pi 1 by 2 pi integral minus pi to pi d tau 1 e to the power I tau 1 L naught minus L naught bar into and then we had e to the power minus tau 2 into L naught plus L naught bar. Nice. In fact, this minus 1 is precisely what's needed to make this exactly the eta. Because there's the q to the power 1 by 24 times 24 times. That's the minus 1. Okay? So now let's go back to our formula. Let's go back to the formula we started writing down. We had d tau 2 by... we still have the integral here over d tau 1. Okay, so we had originally an integral over d tau 2 over 2 tau 2. But remember the that integral now becomes extra 4 pi, so we make it 4 pi tau 2. And then we have an integral d tau 1. Okay? Then we had integral d. Now in our case, this is 26k, d26k over 2 pi to the power 26, and then there was exponential of, we had minus k squared L by 2, but then we redefine L with a factor of alpha, right? So minus k squared alpha prime tau 2 by 2. And then the remaining part is what we've done, the trace. So, over eta of q to the power 24, eta of q bar. So that's our final formula for summing over all the particles of string theory. The vacuum energy for summing over all the particles of string theory. Is that clear? Okay, so now all that remains, is to all that remains is to do the Gaussian integral of a case. Okay, and I'm sure I'll get the factors of 2 wrong. When we did it in string theory, you see here we're dealing with tau whose periodicity is 2 pi. I think in the last class we were dealing with tau whose periodicity was 1. Oh, I'm sorry for that mess up. So there are two natural normalizations in the space of tau's. You know, where the real part of tau is periodicity 2 pi and the real part of tau is periodicity 1. And I used one of them in one discussion and the other one in the other. I'm sorry, we should redo this calculation with extra factors of 2 pi somewhere. So we should do that. Give me a minute to see if I can trace through on the 2 pi. Also, if you remember, last time we defined q to be e to the power I and I 2 pi tau. Here I defined it as just e to the power I tau. Let's say 2 pi. Sorry. Just give me 2 minutes. So the main thing that will change is that we get a 2 pi up here. Basically, we have to take out this tau and make it 2 pi times the original tau. That's the redefinition. Okay? This tau make it 2 pi times the original tau. Okay, let me just. If I think that everything we've done is correct. So I might have, if we mess up by 2 pi in the end, then I have to return to this. I think that everything is correct, but I'm now saying that, now let's make a change of variables. Tau is equal to 2 pi times, tau goes to 2 pi times. I'm sure I get 2 pi. But let's just make the change of variables and see what happens. So we get d tau 2 d tau 1 by 2 tau 2. We get d 26 k by 2 pi by 26. And exponential of minus k squared alpha prime pi eta q to 24 eta q bar. Okay, now we do the Gaussian integral. Okay, now we do the Gaussian integral. So, once again, the factors of pi go away. Because we get pi to the power 26 by 2 from the formula for the Gaussian integral. But we get 1 over pi to the power 26 by 2 because there's this pi here. We get 1 over alpha prime to the power 13. And so we've got d tau 2 d tau 1 by 2 tau 2 alpha prime to the power 13, 2 pi to the power 26, 2 pi to the power 26, and then we get, where was that? Where we lost my tau 2 here is tau 2, so that's tau 2 to the power 13, then eta of q to the power 24. Eta q bar. What? 2 minutes. Okay? And this is exactly, this is d2 tau. I messed up with a 2 pi, right? I need one extra 2 pi. Anyway, d2 tau. Tau 2 is the same thing as imaginary part of tau. Okay? So this is 2 tau 2 squared times alpha prime the whole thing. 13, 2 pi to the power 26, and then times 1 over tau 2 to the power 12 tau to the 24, eta of the 24, eta 1, eta of part of the 24. Stupid sense. Okay, up to a 2 pi that I lost somewhere, which I apologize for, and I'm going to request you to try to trace through. We just do it correctly, we lost the 2 pi somewhere. Okay, but up to that 2 pi, anyway, I won't speculate on this. I think. Okay, up to that 2 pi, up to that 2 pi is even by exactly the same formula. But with one key difference. And this is the main point of this lecture. The one key difference is the range of integration of tau. What is the range of integration of tau in this formula? Remember, tau 2 was what was added. It was integrated from 3 and 0 to 3. What about tau 1? With our new or minus half to half in because the periodicity is 1, so it's some range of 1. So let's look at it. So let's look at these two integration ranges. In string theory, we were doing the integration over this region. In this calculation, we're doing the integration over this region. Hey, both of these are minus half and half. Minus half and half. So it's almost exactly the same answer, but with the key difference in the difference in integration domain. The key difference being the difference in the integration domain. Okay, now we're gonna have to stop this lecture now in a minute, so let me just tell you in words, we'll explain this in formulas later. But you see, the region tau 2 going to 0 was, in this particle language, the limit of very small particle parts. It is the region of integration space over moduli that gives rise to the ultraviolet divergences of quantum field theory. We're doing the same calculation here, except that that region that was ultraviolet divergent just does not appear. Okay, it's a bit fake to say it doesn't appear, as we will explain.
It's like
Exactly. So, there is a way of interpreting the answer in which the UV divergence just does not appear. That's a way of looking at it. So, you see, you've hit the key point. Suppose we were to go to this guy, for instance. Then, we would be approaching here. So you can ask, what is the map of this region of this domain there, and since this is related by tau goes to 1 by tau, you see, it's there. So, all of the potential UV divergences of this picture have been pushed away to the IR, very long distances, in this region. Okay, so we see a fundamental property of string amplitudes that we will see again and again and again. That is, divergences from one point of view are ultraviolet in string theory can be related to something in the infrared. As we will see in the next class, that's great because infrared properties are physical. Okay? So any issue about a divergence, potential divergence in string theory is related to some infrared phenomenon, which are